everyone.
Good afternoon.
Good to see you all. Good to see a good turnout here. We had a lot of people who couldn't come but wanted to come. So I just want to let you know, Danielle from our development office is here. She's going to record this session, although Karen has offered to do a makeup session. So for those who couldn't come, if you'll let them know, maybe we'll schedule another date because it's pretty interactive and I think it really brings more to you to actually have it live in person. But we're going to go ahead and get started, so thank you all for coming. And for many of you, you already know Karen Meyer. She's from the school district, and she is a wonderful presenter, and she has a lot of knowledge. So, Karen, take it away.
Okay, so we're going to start off with introductions. And what you have to think about is your name, your favorite book, and why is it your favorite book? So I have to tell you, this is embarrassing because I have a children's book. That's my favorite book that's on the screen. Like, I don't get to do like adult reading. It's kind of scary. So I usually do read children's books, or I read professional books about how to become better teachers and helping my teachers become better teachers of reading. So there is no fiction in my life right now besides books like this. So my name's Karen Myers. I'm instructional facilitator for literacy for the Tacoma School District. I work with all 35 elementary schools. My favorite book is Skippy John Jones. If you don't know Skippy John Jones is a Siamese cat who really thinks he's a chihuahua. And Skippy does some very naughty things like jump on his bed. And when he jumps on his bed and jumps up and looks at himself in the mirror, he doesn't see a Siamese cat. He sees himself as a chihuahua. And I do have a chihuahua that lives at my house. Oh. And he has adventures just like Skippy John Jones. So Skippy John Jones goes in his closet and he has all these adventures. So every text about him is about all the adventures that he does. So would you like to be next, and we'll just go around? Your name, a favorite book, and why? So think about the richness that you bring to the conversation today, because you live a readerly life. But when thinking about the work that we've done in the past, we talked about three big things. One, to build a relationship with the student that you're working with, to have that adult-student relationship, that you're a caring adult that's coming in to work with the student who's struggling, or striving, I should say. I don't like to use the word struggling student, a striving student. Have that conversation with them about something that you're reading. We talked about you doing some reading to your student, and then having your student do some reading also. And then the third thing is giving our students an opportunity to practice those reading skills. And that's what we're going to be focusing on today. I know in the past we talked about the relationship building and the adult fluent read aloud, but today we're going to be focusing on students reading and making meaning. Okay, so I wanted to reiterate the three components we have always been talking about, and today this is how it fits into the big picture. All right, so here, you know, I am a teacher, so I have to put my learning targets and success criteria up. Because if we don't know where we're headed today, after the end of the 2 hours, you won't know if we've gotten there or not. Right?
Yeah.
So here's our learning targets. Our learning target is today that you as the tutor will investigate 6 comprehension strategies that good readers use before, during, or after reading. Our kids don't know that's what good readers do. We need to teach them this is what good readers do before, during, and after reading to make sense or make meaning of reading text. If our children are not understanding what they're reading, they're not reading. Let me say that one more time. If our kids are not understanding what they're reading, they're not reading. They're only word calling, right? So reading is making sense and having that inner dialogue while you're reading, that think aloud, those metacognitive strategies that good readers do that need to be explicitly taught to kids. Now, if I'm successful in crafting our activities today over the course of the next 2 hours, then this will be your success criteria. This is what you'll be leaving with. You'll be able to discuss how to support your tutee. I love that word. Your tutee. You'll be able to discuss with a partner of a partner how to support your tutee in each of the 6 strategies. So we're going to go over each of the strategies, and then what does it look like, sound like, and feel like to do this with your mentee. You can also be able to practice with the comprehension conversation cards, because I made them again for you. So we're going to be working with cards and practicing with real text. And before you go, you'll be able to articulate how this new learning today will affect how you work with your tutee or your mentee. Okay, so if I'm successful in crafting the activities today, that's what you're going to walk away with. Now, on the bottom is an article that we're going to be reading and thinking about today, because you know every time I get together with you, we have to do some deep thinking and some reading and some talking. Because thinking, reading, and talking are all interrelated. That's why when we read, we talk. We talk to understand, we comprehend what we've read more, and we want to make sure that we're doing some thinking along the way and get that thinking out up front, okay? So the article that we're going to be reading and thinking and talking about came from the state. The state every year puts out what's called an ELA, English Language Arts, menu of best practices. So what are the best practices that we want to use when working with striving readers? And so this article was a suggestion in that publication that came from this state. And I got it under the part that said adult mentors. Because adult mentors working with students who are striving to become better readers is research-based good practice. So now I want you to know I'm taking a disclaimer. Yes, I took this from the state. Here's my disclaimer. I did not write this text. And there's multiple typo errors in it.
Oh, yes.
And I have to tell you that my English language arts background, I feel like I need to take a knife out of my heart if that I'm going to pass out a piece of text that has typo errors in it. I don't like it. So, yes, the state provided me this resource, but crikey, it has some errors in it. And I want you to know I did not type this. All right? So, you'll see, because I took snippets of the article and I put it in the PowerPoint, and you're going to say, what does that say? So we're going to be kind of like our striving readers who can't comprehend what they're reading because it doesn't make sense, okay? There's like some, not typo errors, there's spacing issues. So there's words that are compressed together, and it makes your head hurt a little bit. Okay, so I wanted to have that disclaimer. So don't, you know, talk to my boss and say, Karen doesn't know how to type. Okay, so here we go. So we're going to start with a read aloud. So close your eyes and just relax. I'm going to read to you. So I want you to imagine you have 3 different tutees, mentees, right? You're working with 3 different students. And so we're going to envision what does it look like, sound like, and feel like for these 3 different students to approach a piece of text and make sense out of it. Okay, so I'm going to read it to you. Mandy put a pink sea castle into the fish tank. Mimi added 6 yellow stones that glowed in the dark. The friends, M and M, have been mixing up the old fish tank all week. Now all we need are the fish, said Mimi. But fish cost money, said Mandy. Okay, open your eyes. It would help if I actually read it. So sorry about that. Let me go back and reread. The friends M&M have been fixing up the old fish tank all week. All right, so here we go. We've got 3 different students trying to make sense out of this piece of text, okay? So reader number 1 is Mark. And Mark, he's really familiar with other stories about M&M, right? Mark has kind of read that whole series of the M&M books. And he knows all about M&M characters, right? So he's familiar with them. He already knows that this story is an adventure about two girls and that their names are Mandy and Mimi because he's read those books. With this knowledge, he's made connections between what he already knows about this book series and what's happening in the story. Mark knows that the author gives clues about the girls' adventures in the title, so just looking at the title, he predicted that the two girls would try to earn money to buy fish for their fish tank, and that their attempts will result in some sort of mishap. Because Mark knows these stories, right? There's always some kind of trouble in these stories, right? Finally, in the end, he asked himself, gee, what kind of trouble will Mandy and Mimi get into in this story before he even started to read? Anymore. Okay, that's one reader. Now we've got a different reader. Lizzie's not familiar with other stories about Eminem. Instead of making a text-to-text connection, she quickly previewed the text. She activated her background knowledge and thought about what does she know about this type of situation and the information in the story. She knows that people put different things in their fish tanks because she has some background knowledge on fish tanks. She knows that they usually do that to decorate them and that fish cost money. So she came to the table knowing this stuff already. Finally, she asked herself, now how will Mandy and Mimi earn money for the fish that they want to buy? And she turned the page to read more. So she approached the text with different background knowledge. But that's what she was thinking while she read this paragraph. Okay, here comes reader number three. He's Paul. Paul also quickly previewed the text. He realized that he doesn't know anything about fish or fish tanks. He imagined that the friends must have a new hobby or a pet or maybe even a homework assignment. While he doesn't know about fish, Paul does know about earning money, about doing chores. He made a text-to-world connection between his prior knowledge and clues in this passage. He ended up reading by asking himself, I wonder if Mandy and Mimi will do chores to earn money for the fish they want. And he turned the page to read more. These are examples of three different pathways to making meaning or making sense out of one piece of text. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna talk about these three kids and what strategies they use before, during, and after reading. We're going to be practicing them so that you can use them with your two T's. Okay? All right. I've set the stage with our learning target, our success criteria, and a little bit about what we're going to be doing. But now I need to chunk and chew. Chunk and chew is a strategy that says our brain can only hold this much. You can't keep talking at kids. Like I can't keep talking at you as adults. So now what I'd like you to do is turn and talk with a partner and talk about what have you heard so far.
What have you
because
heard?
This is your chew. This is your chew. I chunked a piece of our learning together. Now you need to chew. So turn and talk about what you've learned so far. The learning target, the success criteria, what is the job, what are we going to do, what did you hear about those readers? Okay? Talk to the person next to you. Just know that these are the six strategies that we're going to be talking about. So research strategies.
strongly supports the following strategies to be taught explicitly to children. Activating their prior knowledge, answering and generating questions, making and verifying predictions, using mental imagery and visualization. Remember when someone said, oh, I saw the movie after I read the book, but it so wasn't as good as the book? Because when you're reading, you're actively visualizing and creating a little movie in your head, and you're so creative that you can outdo those movie producers, right? It's that after those mental images. I'll tell my kids, close your eyes now. What do you see when we read this piece? Like, how do you visualize it? What do you see? How does the author bring those words to life? Monitoring comprehension and recognizing story structure. So those are the six things we're going to practice today. Ready? Yeah!
I'll answer for you.
Yeah, I am! Let's go, Karen! Okay. All right, so that's what we're using the article to do this work. Okay. Remember, I did not type it.
It's very disconcerting to read it.
It is very disconcerting to read it. And then I did snippets of the article and put it on the PowerPoint, and I'm like, I can't show this in front of grown-ups because it's that, okay. All right. Background knowledge. Read the title of the text. Preview the front cover. What do you think we're going to be reading, right? So here's a book on snakes. Let me tell you, when I activate my background knowledge, it creeps me out. I bought property in Eastern Washington. The first time visiting there, my dog got bit by a rattlesnake. Like, I had no schema about rattlesnakes. I had none. And now I do. So if you chose this particular text to work with your mentee, you would say, what do you think this is going to be about? Look at the title. Look at the pictures. Tell me, what do you know about snakes? Right? You all have some nonfiction texts at your table. You know, what do you know about earthquakes? What do you know about animals in the ocean? What do you know about fall? What do you know? You get it? Okay? You're activating. You're having them bring to surface what they know about the subject. And it's really going to help our readers because it sets the context for the reading. So, now, look at the bottom of page 4. Oh, that's activating. Okay. Where is the part where it says, what does this mean for your tutors? There it is. Okay, it's on page 7. Nope, that's ask and answer questions. Sorry. My post-it note and copy got lost. So, there, how to support your tutee. Okay, it's on the bottom 3/4 of page 5. So get your highlighters. And there's a statement that says, how to support your 2D. And that's the chunk I want you to read. Highlight that, even though some of the words are pushed together. Gotta let go of it. And then talk, as soon as you read the paragraph, then talk at your table with your partner. What does this mean? How could you do this?
I was so excited about what we just read.
Yes.
That I just finished grad school, and this is what you do for textbooks in grad school. So I feel like this, if we can teach kids this, this will help them. It's a lifelong skill.
This is.
So I was really, really excited about this. So thank you.
This is what good readers do.
Yes.
And if you're not a good reader, you're not doing these things. And so instead of pretending like kids are doing it, we need to explicitly teach them. We are talking about, you have limited time as mentors. You only have 45 minutes. You visualize the snake book there. So you would go back and say, well, let's see, what do you know about a snake? And the student says nothing because they have limited background knowledge. Great. What do you want to learn? about a snake. Oh, you want to know what they eat and you want to know where they live. Great. Now let's find out. We're going to read this text together. And then at the end, let's go back and revisit our questions and see if we learned it. And that was your question. What is a KWL chart? That's on the middle of page 6. That's exactly what it is. What do you know about snakes? What do you want to learn about snakes? And what did you actually learn? And you have limited time with our kids, right? You're not like a classroom teacher where you have 7 hours a day, 8 hours a day, right? So you have to say, like you suggested, you're giving them three choices. Here's a book, here's a book, here's a book. Which one do you want to read?
Thank you very much.
Right? Oh, you're going to choose the snakes? Okay, which out of the 6 comprehension strategies are you going to be working on? That's why you're highlighting them. So in the moment, you can decide which one you're going to do. You don't have time to do all 6. But know that good readers do all 6 of these things. So how can you just get them in? Right? How can you explicitly teach them? Mm-hmm. And then your student says, I don't know anything about a snake. I've never seen a snake. Great. Well, what do you want to know about that? If you were to see one, what would you want to ask it? Or the other suggestion is, well, let me think. What do I know about snakes? Again, build background knowledge with the kids. Well, I know this, I know this, and I know this. I'm wondering if it's going to be in the text. I'm wondering if this author is going to confirm what I know about snakes. Let's see. Now, based on what I know, based on the title, what are you wondering about? What do you want to know? Let's see if we can find that in this text. All right. So now we're on to ask and answer questions. Remember our readers? One of them back there said, gee, I wonder if they're going to use their allowance and buy something for their fish tank, right? Or buy the fish for their fish tank. Good readers do that. They look at the title and they're like, huh. Olivia plays soccer. Huh. I wonder what's going to happen in this story. I wonder if she's the goalie. I wonder if she's part of a team, right? Good readers do that. You go book shopping at Barnes & Noble or Borders.
Or Kings.
Or Kings. Or Half Price Books. And you go and you pick up something, you're like, oh, I wonder, let me read the jacket. You activate your background knowledge. What do I know about World War I? What do I know about the genre of mysteries? What do I know about adventurous stories? Does this fit what I want to read, right? So as a good reader, you ask and answer questions. All right, so here's an example. Before beginning the next session with Allison, Tina, the tutor, invites her to talk about what they read last time. Last time we were together, we were reading My Very Own Fairy Tale. So what do you remember from the last time we read? Or last time when we were reading about trucks. Remember, we got as far as the different types of trucks. So what different types of trucks are there before we go on to the next chapter? That's you asking. What about the kids asking? Okay, well, we read about the different types of trucks. Now we're gonna be in this section. So what are you wondering? What are you hoping to find in this section? Let's write down your wonderings. Let's write down your questions. No, by the way, it is a Common Core State Standards that kids ask and answer questions about text, both informational and nonfiction. Informational and literary text, sorry. So, thinking about asking questions, look on the middle of page 7, get your highlighter out, and it says, how to support your tutee. To support their learning, you can, and there's 1, 2, 3, 4 bullet points. Highlight them. Read, think, and then talk with your partner about them. Okay, you've got 45 minutes,
yeah.
Your kids choose their text, and then you're like, okay, now what am I gonna do? Am I gonna do asking and answer questions? Am I going to activate background knowledge? What am I gonna do?
I'm going to ask them what they were doing this week. I'm going to not jump into it.
What happened? You're going to do what?
I'm not going to jump right in on the whole working, I'm going to find out what's been going on in their life a little bit.
Right. Yep. Okay. That's the
intention. You're talking about rebuilding relationships?
Mm-hmm. Every time.
Every time.
Well, I have a question.
Yes.
In terms of, for instance, it says invite the children to keep track of their questions by perhaps writing them down. And I've got first graders and
yep.
second graders
yep.
where it is, they're still struggling
yeah.
with the words.
Yeah.
And what I will have them do is write the words down. And then we use them again in our vocabulary. But some of these strategies seem to be for older children.
They're for all kids. They're for
okay.
all readers. Mm. But thinking that you're not the classroom teacher, you're there for a short little period of time, talk about the, you know, what are you thinking now?
Mm-hmm.
What are you wanting, you know, I wouldn't take the time to have them track their questions.
Okay. There isn't enough time.
There isn't enough time.
No.
So again, reading, thinking, and talking. Okay. All right. What else are you thinking?
Mm-hmm.
Talk about thinking and reading and talking.
That's really good to ask open-ended questions, you know, so that gives a student a lot of freedom at how they can answer that. I like that.
I think the best open-ended question you can ask, so what are you thinking now? We've read another chapter. We've read another page. What are you thinking now? Has your thinking changed? What are you thinking? I need to hear it. Right?
Just remember, we're not into chapter books. None of us are into chapter books.
We need short little pieces of text.
Yeah,
we've read another page. So is it going, like, well, because we're going to be talking about now about predicting and verifying predictions. So what do you think is going to happen next? I don't know. Let's read a page and see. Close the book. Let's talk about it. So what happened? Is it what we thought was going to happen? Or did something else happen? Oh, aren't authors tricky when they put those little twists in, like you guys were talking about with your texts? You love those little plots and the adventures that your authors write, and that's why they're so wonderful books for us to read. That readerly life isn't the life that many of our kids are living, right? We need to give them that readerly life, like that joy that you get when you're reading your mysteries and your adventures. Yes.
And so with our first graders, they're reading like
yep.
sight words. There isn't a plot.
Okay, remember, because when I saw this book, I got real excited about this book. Now, I'm going to have to go to Borders or Half Price Books and see if I can get one of these. So sometimes there's little books like this. I love these books because there's like really great things to talk about in the text. And Mouse sees the tail. Oh my gosh, what do you think is going to happen next? What are you seeing? What are you thinking? What's going to happen? I don't know. Let's read another page. Oh, Mouse sees eyes. He's camping in the forest all by himself, and he gets scared because he's spooked. Like, oh my goodness, what's happening now? He sees more eyes. Now what's happening? What are you going to predict? What's your prediction? What's going to happen next? Let's verify it. Let's read another page and then stop and think, because I don't know. I don't know if I am even brave enough to turn the page. So scary. Like three pairs of eyes in the forest looking at you. Oh my gosh, what would you do? He sees teeth. You know, story structure, story hill, there's always that climax, right? Even in little pattern predictable books. So we need to find books like that. And the end of the story isn't this great. He camps in his house. He wanted to go camping, but it was just too frightening to be in the forest because he saw teeth and eyes and tails and all kinds of scary things, and so that's how the story ends. And the preview is camping is so scary, so my Mouse finds a match that is a much safer place for him to camp. So that you can still, that's why I love these books. Because they're so great and you can have thinking. I was working with a bunch of striving readers in fifth grade, and I did have to get a level L for that student, and had a conversation with that student about what's happening. Why do you think this is happening? I'm really nervous about turning the page because I see guns in these people's hands, and they were herding up these elephants out of Africa. It looks like they're going to take them to the zoo, and I don't know if I want to see this because the baby elephant is hiding in the trees watching all this happening. I just don't know if I can handle it. And the little student goes, "It's all right. I'm here with you." I said, "Okay." So I read the book, and this little guy who was a striving reader said to me, "This was the best story ever. Can I keep it in my book box?" I said, "Absolutely. Next time you come back and visit with me, can you bring another story just like this?" And that's what we've got to find.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Got to find those stories.
Yep.
Right? Even though they're at this level, they can still do the heavy lifting thinking. He says, "You know, when I'm looking at those hunters that are gathering up the elephants into that trailer, I think it was a train," he goes, "I'm thinking those might be antique guns. I can tell because I know a lot about antique guns." I said, "Really? Tell me more about this." And so he went on and on to describe, "I think because of this, I can predict what's going to happen in the next part of the text." Well, he was wrong. But anyway, it was engaging. So here comes strategy number 3. And that is making and verifying predictions. Now, I know the example says chapters, so let go of the word chapters. So after reading a page or two, Tina pauses to model how to make predictions or good guesses about the story. There is actually a word, a big college word, that you need to know because my kids need to know it, and it's called inferring, right? So if you read the title, you read a page or two, you look at the pictures, and you stop to ponder and make a prediction, that's called inferring. So in the middle of page 7 is where making predictions occurs, but the chunk of text that you need to read is on the top of page 8. How to support your tutor. Read, think, and then talk. Allison comes to the point of the story when the girls realize the twins are missing. So here's 2 excerpts of text that is rich to give you rich, vivid mental images. And one's about his name. Okay. "As I realized my journey was over, I looked into the velvet blue sky. The clouds were black as night. I still had one, but I didn't get my last wish, which was for me to find my mother." Here's another example. "The red, slippery snake slithered in between the 2 thick green thickets of leaves. I know as a classroom teacher, we would investigate the author's craft, how real writers use those great words to help paint a picture for their readers. But then I would flip the table and say, now as authors and writers, you have to use good word choice so that you paint the picture for your readers while you're writing." And so kids don't do that. Kids don't take the time to see that. I remember teaching visualization and one of my little kindergartners, he would say to me, "Ms. Myers, I don't see it. I keep closing my eyes. You keep telling me that there's a movie theater in my head, but I just don't see the movie." I go, "It's okay. Just think about what visuals you see." Tyler Turnbull, what a guy. Because it helps us visualize. When you're reading your books as adult readers, you're picturing it in your head. You can add, some cognitive theorists don't call it just mental imagery, they call it sensory imaging, because if you're reading about someone baking or cooking something, you can actually smell it and taste it. So it uses all your senses, and that's what good readers do. They use all their senses and bring themselves. Mm-hmm. Like one of you said, when you read your books, it's like an escape. It's like you're in a different world. Mm-hmm. You're smelling it, you're seeing it, you're visualizing it. And that's the world we want our kids to experience. So if they're reading a piece plus a book, what did you see? Talk to me. What did that look like in your head when the author was describing it that way? I'll tell you what I thought. This is what I saw. What did you see? It's really hard when you were level A. This is a boat. This is a ball. And there's a ball, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is a... It's really hard with those kind of texts. So it does really depend on the types of text that you use. It's really hard to say, well, what did you envision? And there's one big red ball in the middle of the picture, right? Because for our kids who are reading at that stage of reading development, it's highly supported on the picture. The picture is the words for them on level A and level B, right? So it's kind of tricky. How many of you work with kids at level A and level B? Yeah. So that's predictable pattern text and where you get to do some finger sweeping and talking about those things. And if that, how did you know that was a ball? What do you know about balls? Where's the ba-ba-ba? Yeah, that kind of stuff, yeah. So, okay. So you have a chunk of text that you're gonna read about making visualizations. And it's tricky because it says how to support your 2T on the very bottom, the very last line on page 8, but the text is really on the top of page 9.
Yeah.
Okay, so highlight, think, and discuss. Strategy called monitoring comprehension. This is what good readers do. When good readers are reading, and I know you know this, when you're reading and all of a sudden you've gotten to the next page and you have no idea what's going on, you know as a good reader, you go back up and reread.
Yep.
You're like, what did I just read? What? Why am I thinking about my grocery list right now? What? Let me go back and fix it.
Yeah.
Right? Kids don't do that. They just keep reading. So meaning breaks down. They don't know what to do. And so we actually have to teach it. So I found this cute little clip art on Google Images.
On
Google Images. I Googled image. What is a fix-up strategy? So as a classroom teacher, our kids need to figure out what to do if meaning breaks down. So the first part is if it's a word, if it's like a word, you just get, you know those kids. You know those kids because you're working with them. They're reading a sentence, they read the wrong word, and they keep reading.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And at the sentence level, it doesn't make sense, right?
Yep.
So for those kids, my kids, your kids, we need to stop them and say, wait a minute, let me hear that again. You said, does that make sense? And the kids will always say, no. wait a minute, I have to tell you, good readers do that sometimes. They read, and they read something and it doesn't make sense, but this is what they do next. They go, wait a minute, that didn't sound right. And they go back and they reread and they read it again. Now you might see a striving reader do this. They're reading and then they go, right? And then they keep on reading.
Mm-hmm.
They're aware that it didn't make sense, but they're just gonna keep going because maybe if they just keep word calling, you won't notice, right?
Yeah,
so if you see the head shaking, if you see the, I'll say, wait, do you know what I just saw you do as a reader? You did something really smart. You did something that good readers do. And they're like, what did I do? I go, your eyebrow went up. Something's not making sense. Or I just saw you shake your head. No, are you talking to yourself in your head? They're like, no, I'm not. I'm like, you should. You should be talking with yourself. You know that little voice in your head telling you, wait a minute, that doesn't make sense. You gotta start listening to it. That's what good readers do. Good readers do that. They listen to that little voice inside their head saying, wait a minute, what the heck am I reading, right? So that's at the word level, which is that we can't get a whole sentence out without it making sense. If it's the whole story, read a page, and you have, and you're on this book. Look what I see. And you've read a couple pages, and you ask them, "What have we read so far?" And your mentee goes, well, "I don't know." I don't know. And I'm like, "Oh, this is the great opportunity for you to learn something that good readers know. This is so perfect." Do you know what good readers do when they've read a couple pages and they stop and think and they don't know what they've read? They do something that is so smart. They go back to the very beginning and they reread the whole thing over again.
Oh, no.
Oh, yeah. Kiss your brain. You just gave us an opportunity to practice something that good readers do. Because that's what good readers do. Let's do it again. We'll read the next couple. We'll go back to the beginning. We'll read a couple pages. We'll close the book. And then we'll say, now what did I just read? Because part of it is striving readers don't know that they're actually supposed to be paying attention to what they're reading, right? They're just being word callers. They think it's all about decoding and spitting out the words. It's not, because that's word calling. That's not reading. Yay, I'm so glad you don't know what you've read. This is a great opportunity for us to practice what good readers do. Let's close the book. Let's do it again. Read two pages and stop and think. Or maybe we should do one page. What do you think? Should we do one page and stop and think and talk? How do you want to go approach this task? Okay? So on your handout, monitoring comprehension. Is on the very top of page 10. So highlight, think.
Your enthusiasm, like, you know, sometimes I know for myself when I have to go back and read, it feels like such a drag. But like the way that you presented it, the way that you talked to kids about it,
it's
like
a great opportunity.
Yeah, I love your positive, you know, energy.
I don't think they're gonna
kiss your brain.
Yeah.
What a great chance for us to go back and learn something that good readers do. So we're gonna stop now. I'm gonna label it, name it, tell you what good readers do, and then we're gonna practice it. Because you're not teaching that book. You're teaching that student how to become a proficient reader. Mm-hmm. And this is a skill they're gonna take with them for the rest of their lives, right? You want them to be sitting in a room like this, talking about their favorite book and how they get lost in their favorite book while they're working with their mentee in Tacoma School District, right? It's lifelong learning, right? Anything else? Yeah.
We're just wondering how teachers do this in a room with, you know, 25 kids who are all in different places. I mean, it's this.
Well, you're asking me about the model I wanted. Why, I would love to tell you about the model in Tacoma. Alright, so in Tacoma School District, we have just published a literacy framework for all of our teachers, all 815 of my teachers, right? And we do it through a workshop model. So let me give you a real example of a workshop model. So a workshop model is whole group instruction, small group instruction, one-on-one conferring. So you know how you're doing one-on-one work with your mentees? Teachers are doing one-on-one conferring with their readers all the time. So let me give you a strategy. Okay, so one of the fix-up strategies, this is what good readers do. If it's at the word level, right, they sound it out. oh, I can't model that one, because that's like the least effective strategy there is. Oh, I can't do that one. Ugh. Okay, look for prefixes or smaller word parts, so chunking it out. So I'm reading the text, and I just did this morning. I was working at Read, and one of the kids was reading a book about tornadoes, and it was real apparent to me right away that this text was way too hard for him. The first sentence, it was way too hard, but he was really excited about the content. And I said, do you know that I lived in Chicago my whole life? Did you know that I've been in a tornado? Do you want to hear about how the building came crashing down on me? Oh, that's really cool stuff. Let's read. Right? So one of the strategies he needed, because he was struggling, was chunking out the word. Let's take a look at this word. You're trying to figure it out. Let's look at the word parts. And let's see the parts of the word that you know, and then let's take all those parts of the word that you know and put it together, and let's see if it makes sense. So I would be having all my babies, even if they're fifth graders, up at the carpet with me, and I would be teaching this. Boys and girls, today we're going to be talking about a fix-it-up strategy. We're going to be talking about a strategy of what happens when you come to a word that you don't know. We're going to look for word parts that you do know, a prefix or a suffix or the middle of the word, the base, the root. We're going to look for words that you know, and we're going to read those parts, and then we're going to cover up that part, and we're going to try to look at the other chunks and see if we can figure them out. And now let me show you how it works. I get a text. I put it on the document camera. I put it up where the kids can see it. We're going to practice it. Now today, boys and girls, when you go off to your own independent reading, I want you to be practicing this fix-up strategy, because it's really going to help you as a reader. Now they go off, I pull this group. These are my superstars. They're coming with me. We're going to be doing a book, a guided reading group, and we're going to be practicing the fix-it-up strategy while we're doing it. Eventually, as I start conferring with you and you and you and you and you, I'm going to expect you to start applying that new strategy into your own independent reading. And so eventually it's called, in our district we call it the gradual release of responsibility. So I teach you for a whole group, I practice it in small group, and then I expect you eventually to be taking that skill and applying it into your own reading. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
It's really a great model. It's really a great model for instruction. We can talk about that all day. Okay. I won't bore you.
Can we ask a question about pronunciation? So I don't know if I'm doing this right, pronunciation. So I have a student, her first language is Vietnamese.
Mm-hmm.
She could not say probably. So I was doing probably. I don't know if that's the right way to do it. Like, what
chunking
would you
it out. You're chunking it out.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so that is the right strategy.
Yeah.
Okay.
In fact, even before you read that word, you can think about that word in the chunks of the beats. We call it beats in kindergarten, which is the syllabication of it. So probably, how many beats are in that word? Three.
Okay.
If you're going to be writing it, let's start with the first chunk. Prob. Write it down. Ready? Blee. Prob. Write a. Blee. So yeah, that's a great way. How do you like my story hill? Isn't it great? They call it a story mountain. I call it a story hill. So all good stories. Now we're talking literary, right? We're not talking informational and nonfiction. We're talking literary. All literary stories have a story hill or a story mountain. That's how all good stories are. They start out introducing the characters and the setting. And then they get into it. Then they go into the build it up, where something's going to start to happen. Then it goes into the set it up, which is the climax, right? I tell kids it's usually the saddest part of the story, the happiest part of the story, the scariest part of the story, and then to that problem comes the resolution, right? We, as grown-ups, we have internalized what a story structure is. We know that all stories go through that climax and resolution. They solve the problems. We know that. We look for it when we're reading our romance novels. When we're reading our adventure stories, we can't wait to get to that conflict, right? That climax on that story. Kids don't know that. We need to teach it to them, that there's a structure. The author introduces the characters and the settings, then it gets built up, then there's a problem, then there's a resolution, and then there's an ending. And it's pretty predictable in literary texts. And if kids know that, they're going to comprehend what they read, the stories that they read, much easier. So now what you're going to do is you're going to look at that section, which is on page 11 on the top. Learning about characters and thoughts and themes and how to help your two teens. All right. We have this many minutes. I just reset your brains. You have this many more minutes. And so I want you to practice. So you have some text at your table. You have a fiction and a nonfiction. I'd like you to think of the comprehension strategies, choose a couple, and practice them with the text. Some strategies make more sense when you're using informational text, like, what do you know about frogs? As opposed to, what do you know about Pinkalicious, right? That wouldn't work so well. So go ahead and start practicing some of the strategies using the text that you have at the table with your partners.